Hello, I'm Akinori Hosoyamada from NTT and Nagoya University. This is a talk on quantum collision attacks on reduced SHA-256 and SHA-512. This is a joint work with my colleague, Yu Sasaki. So this is our results. We showed the first dedicated quantum collision attacks on SHA-2. More concretely, we showed a 38-step attack on SHA-256 and 39-step attack on SHA-512. And in the classical setting, the collision attacks reach 31-step for SHA-256 and 27-step for SHA-512. So we extended the number of attack steps by 7 and 12. However, these steps are still far from full rounds. Full steps, because the number of full steps are 64 and 80 respectively for SHA-256 and for SHA-512. And the attack idea is like this. We convert classical semi-free start collisions on 38-step SHA-256 and 39-step SHA-512 into collisions in the quantum setting. And our attacks are valid in the setting of time-space trade-off, but invalid in other quantum settings. So in the quantum setting, we can consider three settings depending on available computational resources. I will explain details later. And next, first, I would like to explain about the basics of classical collision attacks. So in the classical setting, the generic attack or the birthday attack finds a collision of a random function in time 2 to the power n over 2 if the output length of the random function is n. And so, in the classical setting, a dedicated collision attack on a concrete hash function is considered to be valid if and only if its time complexity is less than the birthday bound 2 to the power n over 2. And next, I'd like to explain about the number of attack steps. Usually, a hash function is made from a smaller primitive, such as a compression function or a permutation, and so on. And such compression function and permutation iterates many steps like this. And suppose a compression function iterates 10 steps like this. Then, usually, it is very hard to find a valid collision attack on original primitive. And so, when an original primitive is hard to break, usually symmetrically cryptanalysts try to break its reduced step variants. And this picture illustrates the case of a 6-step variant. So here, we try to find a valid collision attack on this 6-step function. And if we succeed to find a valid collision attack on this function, then we try to find a dedicated collision attack on 7-step function. And then we try to attack 8-step function and 9-step function, and then finally the original 10-step function. And if the original 10-step function is broken, then we consider that the hash function is broken. And the important thing is, how many steps can we break, rather than the actual complexity? This is the important point. And next, I would like to provide a brief remark on differential cryptanalysis. So in the classical setting, one of the most basic approaches to mount a collision attack is differential cryptanalysis. And very roughly speaking, when we have a suitable differential trail of which probability is p, then we can mount a collision attack of time 1 over p. And this attack is valid on if and only if the time complexity 1 over p is less than 2 to the power n over 2. So it means that the differential trail leads to a valid attack only if the differential probability p is greater than the birthday bound 2 to the power minus n over 2. And next, I would like to explain about some observations on dedicated quantum collision attacks that we presented at EuroFlip 2020. So, as I mentioned before, we can consider three settings in the quantum setting, depending on available computational resources. In the first setting, we assume that a small quantum computer of polynomial size and a large quantum RAM of exponential size are available. In this setting, the best generic collision attack, or the best generic algorithm, is the BHD algorithm, which finds a collision in time 2 to the power n over 3 by using a quantum RAM of size 2 to the power n over 3. However, it is unclear whether such a large quantum RAM is available. So, we also consider these other two settings. In the second setting, we assume that the efficiency of a quantum algorithm is measured by its time-space trade-off. And we assume that a quantum computer of size S and classical computer of size S are available. In this setting, the best generic collision attack is the parallel law method, as observed by Bernstein. And its trade-off is T is equal to 2 to the power n over 2 over S. And in the third setting, we assume that a small quantum computer of polynomial size and a large classical memory is available. In this setting, the best generic algorithm is the CNS algorithm, which finds a collision in time 2 to the power 2 n over 5 by using a classical memory of size 2 to the power n over 5. So, we consider these three settings, and we consider generic attack in each setting. And next, the important point is, the quantum speedup for generic collision attack is always less than quadratic. Because in the classical setting, the generic complexity is 2 to the power n over 2. And in each quantum setting, the generic complexity does not achieve 2 to the power n over 4. We can say that the quantum speedup for generic collision attack is always less than quadratic. And next, I would like to explain about the speedup for differential cryptanalysis. Very roughly speaking, the time to find a collision with a differential path of probability p is, in the classical setting, 1 over p. But in the quantum setting, this can be speed up like this, the square root of 1 over p, by using the global search. And so, very roughly speaking, we can obtain a quadratic speed up for differential cryptanalysis. And so, the situation can be summarized like this. For generic collision attack, we can always obtain less than quadratic speed up. But for differential cryptanalysis, we can obtain a quadratic speedup by using the global search. And so, the differential cryptanalysis becomes relatively stronger in the quantum setting. And this implies that the validity condition p is greater than 2 to the power minus n over 2 can be relaxed in the quantum setting. For example, in the first quantum setting of quantum setting where a small quantum computer and large quantum RAM is available, the generic complexity is 2 to the power n over 3. And the complexity of differential cryptanalysis is like this. So, in this quantum setting, dedicated collision attack based on differential cryptanalysis is valid only if the square root of 1 over p is less than the generic complexity 2 to the power n over 3. And this is equivalent to this condition. And here, please note that this condition is much relaxed from the classical condition p is greater than 2 to the power minus n over 2. And so, in particular, the differential probability p may lead to a valid attack, even if p is less than the birthday bound 2 to the power minus n over 2. And similarly, in the second quantum setting of time-space trade-off, the generic complexity is like this. And so, in this setting, a collision attack based on differential cryptanalysis that requires space S is valid only if the time complexity, the square root of 1 over p, is less than the generic complexity, this one. And this is equivalent to this condition. And this means that the differential probability p may lead to a valid attack even if p is very close to 2 to the power minus n, if the space S required to differential cryptanalysis is very small. And so, at Eurocrypt 2020, we observed that the condition for differential probability p can be relaxed in the quantum setting. And this means that dedicated quantum collision attacks can reach more steps than classical attacks. And we indeed showed delegated quantum attacks, quantum collision attacks on ASMMO and Whirlpool that break more steps than classical attacks. However, these functions, ASMMO and Whirlpool, are less popular compared to more popular functions such as SHA-2 or SHA-3. So, after Eurocrypt 2020, we had this question. Can we similarly extend the number of attacked steps of SHA-2 in the quantum setting? This is the starting point of our research. And next, I would like to explain about the basics of SHA-2. So, SHA-2 is the current most popular hash function family standardized by NIST, and it consists of several functions, these functions. And the first one, SHA-224, is a truncated version of SHA-256. And these functions are also truncated versions of SHA-512. And SHA-2 is built based on the Davis-Meyer construction and the Magruder-Dangard construction. And recall that the Magruder-Dangard construction looks like this. First, the input message is padded and splitted like this. And then the first message block is processed with the compression function with the initial value. And then this output or chaining value is again processed with the second message block by using the compression function. And again, this chaining value is processed with the third message block by using the compression function. And this value becomes the output. And the important point is, this initial value is specified and fixed constant. So this is the Magruder-Dangard construction. This construction converts compression function, a small compression function of fixed input output length, into a large hash function of variable input length. And next, to make a compression function, we usually use a block cipher. So we first make a block cipher and then convert it into a compression function by using constructions such as Davis-Meyer construction or MMO construction or MP construction and so on. And SHA-2 uses the Davis-Meyer construction, which looks like this. So in this construction, the T corresponds to the input message of the T of the block cipher corresponds to the input message of the compression function. And the message of the block cipher corresponds to the chaining value of the compression function. And then the output of the block cipher is added with the chaining value, like this. Actually, this operation is not a modular addition in SHA-2, but the operation does not play a significant role. So I do not explain details here. Anyways, in summary, SHA-2 is built like this. First, there is a block cipher, and it is converted into a compression function by using the Davis-Meyer construction. And then it is converted into a hash function of variable input length by using the Magruder-Dangard construction. And next, I would like to explain about semi-free start collision. So, recall that a collision of a Magruder-Dangard hash function looks like this. So messages are different, but outputs are equal. And next, the initial values are also equal. And the important point is, this value is equal to the original specified constant. This is the important point. And next, this is a semi-free start collision of a hash function. Again, messages are different and output values are equal and IVs are equal. But now the important point is this value IV prime is not necessarily equal to the original specified constant. So in summary, when we talk about collision, we assume that IVs are equal to the specified original specified value. And when we talk about semi-free start collision, we assume that IVs are the same but not equal to the original specified constant. So this is the difference between collision and semi-free start collision. And next, I would like to explain about a previous work on SHA-256 in the classical setting. So in the classical setting, Mendel et al. Showed a 31-step collision attack on SHA-256 and 38-step semi-free start collision attack on SHA-256. These attacks are based on differential cryptanalysis and differential characteristic, and some parts of conforming message pairs and internal states are searched simultaneously with automated tools. And the characteristic is very complicated, like this. This is the 31-step characteristic. And I do not explain details, but this part corresponds to some conditions for internal states. And this part corresponds to some conditions for message words. And roughly, very roughly speaking, these characters 0 and 1 and N and U says that there exist some strict conditions for these bits. And other bits denoted by hyphen means that these bits do not have such strict conditions. And so anyways, the characteristic is very complicated, and the important point is the 31-step collision attack is mounted by converting 31-step semi-free start collisions into a collision. This is the important point, and I would like to explain details next. So Mendel et al. Showed that we can make many semi-free start collisions of the compression function from that complicated differential characteristic. Some part of messages and some part of IVs and some part of internal states are fixed by the differential characteristic. However, some parts still have some degrees of freedom. I mean, these parts still can be chosen freely. And this means that the semi-free start collision attack works for many IVs, 2 to the power 160 choices of IV primes. However, unfortunately, this semi-free start collision cannot be a collision of hash function because this value is not same as the original specified value. And so, Mendel et al. Converted these many semi-free start collisions into a two-block collision by using these degrees of freedom. So, suppose that this is the second block, and this will be the first block of Magrudangad hash function. And suppose that this is the original specified constant. And next, so here, when we test 2 to the power 96 random message M0 here and compute the output value, here 96 comes from 256 and 160. And 256 is the length of output and length of IV. And 160 comes from here. And when we test such many M0, then one of the outputs will match an IV prime of the second message block. And if we find such match, then it means that the pair of M0 and M1 and M0 and M1 prime will be a two-block collision of the Magrudangad hash function because this part, this value is the original specified constant. And so this means that we can find a two-block collision in time 2 to the power 96 by testing 2 to the power 96 messages here. Actually, the attack is more complicated, but a rough overview is something like this. And actually, this attack can be generalized like this. If we can make many semi-free start collisions for 2 to the power x choices of IV primes, then we can find a two-block collision in time 2 to the power n minus x by testing 2 to the power n minus x messages here. And so, in the classical setting, this attack of complexity 2 to the power n minus x is considered to be valid only if this equation, this inequality holds. And this is equivalent to this condition. So this condition is the validity condition for the number of initial values in the classical setting. And Mendel et al. Showed not only the 31-step collision attack, but also a 38-step semi-free start collision attack in the same paper, but it is not converted into a collision attack. because the parameter x for the 38-step attack is not large enough. And next, in the quantum setting, our attack idea is the validity condition. This one may be relaxed in the quantum setting in the same way that the condition, validity condition for differential probability can be relaxed in the quantum setting. And next, I'd like to explain about our idea of conversion of semi-free state collisions into collisions in the quantum setting. So, recall that we can consider three quantum settings, and in our paper, our focus is this setting of time-space trade-off. And next, so recall that in the classical setting, the time complexity of two-block collision attack is like this, 2 to the power n minus x. And in the quantum setting, we can speed up this attack to the square root of 2 to the power n minus x by using the global search. And so, and if s qubits are available, the attack, our two-block quantum collision attack can be parallelized, and the time complexity becomes the square root of 2 to the power n minus x over s. And in the setting of time-space trade-off, the generic complexity is like this. And so, the Dirichlet attack of this complexity is valid if this inequality holds, and this is equivalent to this condition. This condition, and please note that this condition, x is greater than 0, is much relaxed from the classical condition, x is greater than n over 2. Actually, the condition for x, this condition, will be stronger than this one, because here I'm ignoring many things. For example, qubits required to implement global or time for sub-procedures, and so on. But still, the new condition, x is greater than 0, seems much weaker than x is greater than n over 2, the classical condition. And actually, we mounted dedicated quantum collision attacks on SHA-2 based on this idea. And next, I'd like to explain about our main results. In the quantum setting, based on that observation for the number of initial values, we converted the 38-step semi-free state collision attack on SHA-256 by Mendel et al. And 39-step semi-free state collision attacks on SHA-512 by Dobranik et al. Into a two-block collision. These semi-free state collision attacks are not converted into a collision in the classical setting because the number of IVs are not enough. And with some analysis and computer experiments, we confirmed that the attacks are valid in the quantum setting. Actually, this sum analysis is not so much trivial, but I cannot explain details because I do not have enough time today. So please read our paper for details. And the time complexity of the attacks are like this. And finally, I'd like to provide the summary of today's my talk and some future directions. In our paper, we showed the first dedicated quantum collision attacks on SHA-2, 31-step collision attack on SHA-256, and 39-step attack for SHA-512. And the idea is, we converted classical semi-free state collisions into collisions in the quantum setting. And next, there are many functions of which construction is similar to the construction of SHA-2. For example, live memory, 160, and so on. But so far, we haven't found any two-block dedicated quantum collision attacks on these functions, because existing characteristics on these functions are not suitable for our idea of a two-block quantum collision attack. Nevertheless, finally, I would like to emphasize that we should revisit differential characteristic search activities, and the possibility of quantum attacks should be taken into account, because even if a differential characteristic does not lead to a valid attack in the classical setting, it may lead to a valid collision attack in the quantum setting. That's all. Thank you for your attention.